This is a revision podcast for EdExcel IGCSE Physics, and this is on Topic 6, Magnetism and Electromagnetism. It's also suitable for dual award science. Permanent magnets have two poles, a north pole and a south pole. When you place two opposite poles next to each other, the magnets attract, and when you place two similar poles next to each other, they repel. The lines that you see drawn are magnetic field lines. These are lines which point in the direction that a compass would point if placed at that particular point. For example, a compass placed here would point up towards the South Pole. Here you can see compasses placed end to end, and you can see that they follow a field line. The arrow of a compass is a little north pole. It's therefore repelled from a north pole of an adjacent magnet and attracted towards the South Pole. If you're doing separate sciences, you need to know about magnetic domains. Magnetic domains are tiny magnetic regions which can be made to align. Here you can see domains aligned in random directions, and here all the domains point in the same direction. Each of these domains is like a little compass needle or little magnet, and here the net effect is that there is a magnetic field produced by the material, but here all the fields cancel. Hard magnetic materials are materials in which the domains stay aligned after you've caused them to be aligned, and you can make them be aligned, in this case by supplying a current around this coil of the electromagnet. Soft magnetic materials are materials where the domains move back to the random positions after you take away the magnetic field that caused them to move in the first place. Magnetic objects attract to permanent magnets because of induced magnetism. These paperclips are not themselves magnets, but they are made of a magnetic material, such as iron. When you bring them near to a magnet, the domains line up in the paperclip temporarily, so it becomes magnetic. A south pole is induced at the top, and this attracts to the north pole. This means that the bottom of the paperclip will be a north pole, and this itself can induce magnetism in another paperclip, making a south pole at the top, and in this way you can get a chain of paperclips hanging. Separate scientists need to know about the magnetic field surrounding a current-carrying wire. Current flows from positive to negative, so up this wire, and the magnetic field is circular around the wire. The right-hand grip rule shows you the relationship. The thumb shows the direction of conventional current, that's from plus to minus, and the fingers wrap round in the direction of the magnetic field. If you wrap a wire in a coil, then you get a field that looks like this. And if you spread out a coil into this shape called a solenoid, you end up with a field that looks a little like a bar magnet. Notice in the middle of the field lines are straight and evenly spaced. That gives a uniform region of magnetic field. Again, the right-hand grip rule can be used to explain. The thumb points in the direction of the magnetic field lines through the centre of the coil, and the fingers wrap around in the direction of conventional current. When a current passes at right angles to a straight, uniform magnetic field, a force is produced at right angles to both the current and the field. The easiest way to think about the relationship between these three things is using your left hand. The thumb points in the direction of force that the wire will experience. The first finger shows the direction of magnetic field. Remember, field lines point from north to south. And the second finger points in the direction of current. That's from plus to minus. This is called Fleming's left hand rule. Note that if the current is in the same direction as the field, i.e. along a field lines, then there won't be any force produced. The reason this happens is due to the interaction between the magnetic field around a straight wire and the field between two poles. And you can see here the shape of the field is sometimes called the catapult field. Moving electrons experience a force if they're travelling at 90 degrees to a magnetic field. That's because an electric current is really a flow of electrons travelling in the other direction down the wire. Remember, conventional current is represented as flowing from plus to minus, but really electrons flow the other way. Here, if an electron flows to the right in a magnetic field at 90 degrees to it, sticking out of the page, the electron will experience a force pushing it up. This force will make the electron move in a circle. If it travels in a uniform magnetic field, always up in this diagram, the electron will always be pushed towards the center of the circle. Its direction continuously changes and the force continuously changes. The catapult field is put to good use in the design of a motor. Here, the external circuit provides the current which flows from the positive terminal, that's the long symbol. It flows around here, in through the brush and in through the commutator. One side of the coil is connected to the commutator, and so current travels up this side of the coil and around the coil many times. Eventually it leaves through the commutator on the other side and out through the brush and back to the cell. If you apply the left-hand rule on either side of this coil, you'll see that one side is pushed down and one side is pushed up. Field lines go from north to south, and current is this direction into the page. That means the force on this side of the coil will be down. If you reverse the direction of current, you'll also find that the force is pushed up. And so this coil will rotate in this direction. After half a turn, the commutator reverses the connections to the coil, so the current still flows around in the same direction, anti-clockwise when viewed from above in this drawing. If you want to make a force bigger with a motor, you'd need a bigger magnetic field, so stronger magnets on the outside, a greater electric current, or more turns of wire. You'd also increase the torque of a motor with a larger area of coil. This drawing shows the magnetic field lines that use to produce a catapult field in a motor. Like this previous slide, you can see that one side of the coil is pushed up and the other side is pushed down. A loudspeaker also uses the motor effect. It has a pair of permanent magnets, north pole and a south pole, and the south pole is inside this coil of wire. On this side, you get an interaction between a current travelling down into the page and the permanent magnet at right angles to it. If at this point current is down into the page, then this wire will be pulled towards the bottom, and so the speaker cone will be pulled in. So the coil in the field produces a force. But the coil carries an alternating current, so it keeps changing direction. And that means that the force on the speaker cone will keep changing direction. And therefore the speaker cone will vibrate at the same frequency as the alternating current supplied to the coil. This makes a sound that's the same pitch as the frequency of the electricity which is supplied to the coil. A voltage is induced across a coil when the magnetic field through the coil changes. The induced voltage may cause a current to flow in the coil. So here, if the magnet was moved towards the coil, the ammeter needle would move and then go back to the centre when the magnet was stationary. If you then took the magnet away, the ammeter needle would move in the opposite direction. Once the magnet's a long way away from the coil, the ammeter needle would remain stationary in the centre. You can also induce a voltage across a wire if you move a straight wire through a magnetic field at 90 degrees to it. So here, when the wire is moving in direction 1, a voltage would be generated across this voltmeter here, or an ammeter would show a current flowing in the wire. When the wire is moved in the other direction through the magnetic field, the voltmeter would move in the other direction. But when the wire is stationary in the coil, not moving, it's not cutting through any lines of magnetic field, and no voltage would be induced. The induced voltage can be made bigger by moving the magnet faster, in this case, winding more turns around the coil, or using a stronger magnetic field. In this case, you can also move the wire faster, use a number of turns of wire, or a stronger magnetic field. A dynamo is a rotating magnet inside a set of coils. As the magnet rotates relative to the coil, the magnetic field through the coil will change, and when it does so, it induces a voltage across the coil. As it keeps changing, the output voltage will be positive and then negative. And so we get an alternating voltage and therefore an alternating current output. A generator works by rotating a coil through a magnetic field. Here, a straight uniform field is present from north to south. The wire cuts through the magnetic field lines and a voltage is induced across the wire. It will also be induced in the other direction in the other wire that's now moving up through the magnetic field. The coil is connected to the external circuit by these pair of slip rings. That means that the output of the generator is alternating current, as the coil is always connected to the same side of the external circuit, and the wire moves up through the field and then moves down, so the voltage will be positive and then negative from any one wire. If we plot a graph of voltage against time for a generator, because it's an alternating current output, you get an alternating voltage waveform. If you were to spin the coil, or a magnet in the case of a dynamo, faster, in fact at double the speed of rotation, you get an output voltage that looks like this. Note that the amplitude of the voltage is double. As it's going twice as fast, you'll induce twice the voltage across the wire. But note also that the frequency has increased. The frequency is now double. Here we get one complete wave in red in the amount of time that the blue makes half a complete wave. So you get a bigger output voltage, but you also get an increase in frequency. Separate scientists need to know about transformers. These use a changing current through the primary coil of wire, that's the red coil, which creates a changing magnetic flux through the core. A core is normally made of laminated sheets of iron. This changing magnetic flux induces a voltage across the secondary coil. So we change from electrical energy into magnetic energy and then back into electrical energy again. When answering a question like this, it's important to emphasize that the changing flux induces a changing voltage. For unless you have a changing magnetic field, you don't induce any voltage. The reason we use transformers is to change voltage from one side to another. The voltage changes in the same way as the ratio of turns changes. So here, if you have more turns on the primary and fewer on the secondary, you'll have more voltage on the primary side and less voltage on the secondary. The ratio, input voltage divided by output voltage, is the same as primary turns divided by secondary turns. And this exam syllabus specifies that as Vp over Vs is Np over Ns, where V stands for voltage, N stands for number of turns, and P stands for primary and secondary. Let's see that in an example. If a transformer has 500 turns on the primary and 1200 turns on the secondary, the input voltage is 12 volts. What would the output voltage be? In this equation, I want to make output voltage the subject. That's Vs. To rearrange that equation, the simplest way would be to invert both fractions to make Vs over Vp equals to Ns over Np. I can do the same to both sides of the equation. I'd then multiply through by Vp to make Vs the subject of the equation. Substituting in the numbers I have, the number of turns on the secondary is 1200 and 500 on the primary, multiply by 12 volts, gives 28.8 volts for the final answer. Transformers are used in power distribution. If you can say a transformer is 100% efficient, then we can apply the formula input power equals output power. And as electrical power is voltage times current, you can say that voltage times current on the primary is the same as the voltage times current on the secondary. That means that if you increase the voltage with a step-up transformer, you will also reduce the current that's produced. Let's see that in an example. If a step-up transformer increases from 240, that's UK mains voltage, to 48,000 volts, and the input current is 100 amps, what would the output current be? Well, we need to rearrange this equation to make output current, that's I on the secondary, as the subject. And that would be Vp over Vs multiplied by Ip. substitute in the numbers I've been given, and the answer comes out to be half an amp. You can see that the current reduces by 200 times as the voltage has increased by 200 times. So you can see that step-up transformers that increase the voltage also reduce the current. So step-up transformers increase the voltage for transmission on the national grid, and that reduces the current that's needed to be transmitted along these wires. And lower currents means less energy is lost as heat in the wires. Step-down transformers are used at the other end to reduce the voltage to the customers back to a safer domestic level. So to summarise, if you're doing the core, we've studied permanent magnets, the motor effect, loudspeakers, induction, and dynamos and generators. And if you're doing separate science, you also need to know about induced magnetism, electromagnets and their fields, domain theory, transformers, and electrical power distribution. Good luck!